name is Kimberly K. Malone, and I'm one of the reference and instruction librarians here at St. Elizabeth's College Library. So we hold these series in the library every Thursday, except for the first and last Thursday of the quarter, because we see it as an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. So whether or not you agree with everything you hear here today, or read the books on our shelves, or find our databases, we want everyone to have access to a variety of viewpoints and perspectives so that we can all learn and grow from each other. So you'll notice a number of resources highlighted up here. All of these are available for checkout. If you're interested in learning more about this topic or topics like it, you can always go to the reference desk, big desk in the middle of the room, two computers, two people sitting there, and we're happy to find you resources. And you'll notice, if you want to take a peek at our schedule, that we have faculty, staff, students, and community members, but we especially love having students lead these sessions, and they have done so very successfully in the past. If you are interested and passionate in a topic and want to lead one of these, come talk to myself or Elisa. Elisa's waving, she's right over there. And we're happy to figure out how we can get you on the schedule for fall quarter, right? Spring's all filled up. So, next week I want to make sure that everybody knows that Veronica Barrera-Cold will be leading a session on Losing Our Public Schools, Lessons from the Student Revolution in Chile. And that immediately after that COSI, there will be a film screening of Resistencia. I won't even pretend that I know that I said that correctly. And that is a documentary about last year's public school occupation in Brazil, right? So we have flyers if you're interested in that event, and feel free to take one with you and learn more about that occupation in the COSI and the film after. But today, I'm so happy to introduce Carl Livingston, who will be leading us in a discussion around the Southern strategy against people of darker color. So please join me in welcoming Carl as we get this.
We have the greatest library, and I want to thank you all so much for the invite. The Noon Lecture Series is a great series, and so I'm hoping all of you will constantly and regularly attend those talks. Make sure that's all. I'm Carl Livingston. I am been here like 28 years, and it was about 17 years ago that I first started learning about the Southern strategy. It was about 2 years ago that I think I figured out how it really, really operates. And I am presently shopping a 65-page article that I now know has to be broken up, it's too long. Has to be cleaned up because it's a little too personal. I put myself in it a little too much. Got pictures in it because I can't find a journal right now to publish it. I also know that's a little explosive because I named presidents in it. As overseeing a framework, a subtle, secretive, publicly secretive, and privately, they're real clear about what they're doing, plan to take away the gains of the 1950s through 70s, mainly for the conservatives. Republicans do it and Democrats do it. What I want to present to you is this PowerPoint, but you guys can see it. Okay, so now, my challenge is, I was just working on revising the PowerPoint, and I put it on my jump drive, and now I see that I still have the old PowerPoint that I was using when I was speaking in a religious context, so I just gotta go with that. But I got it in my head, so it's really not a problem. And so, I wanna talk about the Southern strategy, not so much in terms of Jerusalem, and then on this talk right here, I just started with Lauryn Hill, and just use Lauryn Hill's statement about Jerusalem and just connect that. Gave this talk at Life in Richmond Bookstore, which is still hanging on. Sister Vicki died. It's the only African American bookstore in the state of Washington, to the best of my knowledge. And it may close, so hopefully people will be concerned about it and save this bookstore. We've already lost Joseph Zimbabwe's Blacksburg bookstore. And that was just on about 14th and Pike. Hopefully we won't lose this one and have a new store. This is me here, kind of more of a religious bio on me. We're definitely not doing that. Sorry. What is the Southern strategy? Okay, so I'm going to have to bring in a few other things just to help you understand. This is a quote from Michael Steele when Michael Steele was the chair of the Republican Party. So it is a fact, an admission from the Republican Party that they did the Southern strategy. It's an admission. In the law, we call it an admission against interest. Admissions against interests are highly credible. Admitting this implicates the Republican Party. That's what that means. He said it, sadly, after the 2010 mid-year election results, and although the Republicans did pretty well, they didn't do well enough as far as they were concerned. They were ready to throw Michael Steele overboard. Moreover, information came out that members of the party used their party card at strip clubs. That didn't look good when it comes out, especially when you're a family values party. So they said, time to throw Michael Steele overboard. So when the word hit the streets, Rush Limbaugh was leading that because Michael Steele got in a tiff with Rush Limbaugh. Said he ain't really leading the party. We're leading the party. What did he do that for? So I had to fix his name. So that's when he said, hey, my party's been doing the Southern strategy. He backed up off of him and gave him the rest of the term that year. And he didn't bring him up again. The information I want to share with you implicates highest governmental officials in this admission. But to me, no people are more culpable than African Americans and other people of color who benefit from it. Turn the other way. Not really done anything. And of everyone in that group, nobody is more responsive than Michael Steele. How could you burn a bridge you walked across so that others couldn't cross it? Or maybe you've done something worse than that. How could you be the justifying face on a system that is breaking down people that live economically and socially? How can you do that? I couldn't do it. I'd rather be poor and broke. I just couldn't look at myself in the mirror. They backed up off of him. He didn't say it again. That's a shame. So let's learn more about it. So all you have so far is an admission. What is it? All right. I am trying to redefine it. I've never been one to not have confidence and pride, and maybe I'm a little too feeling my oats too much or something. So I'm suggesting to the nation it needs to be redefined because the punch, the impact of what it is not clear from the scholarly works that too often define it in terms of Nixon and maybe Reagan. As a secret system that used to be effective, it ain't working anymore. I don't think that's right. Moreover, others are right to mention that it takes away the gains of the 60s, but I think you actually have to go back to the 50s, so I've changed the definition, and I go back to the 50s now, because I think you gotta bring in Brown versus the Board of Education, because I think the Southern strategy is aimed at trying to get the conservatives, mainly Southerners, but conservatives anywhere, they could be in the W. Give them what you want, what they want. They're going to vote for you, so you got to give them something in exchange. What do they want? They want the 50s back again. They want the 50s back. And the problem for them with the 50s started with Brown versus Board of Education. So it's a piecemeal racist plans of both parties, governmental leaders. Both parties. Republicans do it hard. They did it first. they continue to do it. Democrats do it soft and light. They did it later. They continue to do it. Even Barack Obama did. To win conservative voters, in the case of the Democrats, they want to win them back. It's about winning the biggest prize in the country, which is the presidency of the United States. Moreover, though, because that sets the national agenda, hardens and focuses the issues and priorities of the nation, many people, learning from what the national figures are saying, duplicate that at home. So they say the same stuff that they learned in the conferences, that they learned from being mentored by national leaders, at home. So although this is happening nationally, it's happening in the city near you. Because it works. All right? And there are conservatives there who would like to go back because it gives them privilege. It gives them privilege. And governmental leaders to win conservative voters and in turn secretly take away the equality policies. It's really the 50s through the 70s. This is the thing that sometimes the scholars will mention, sometimes they won't mention. And I think the big problem is that they don't bring it to current times and they don't quantify it. So one of the things I do is I suggest as a layperson, I'm a little embarrassed because I know that minds better than me are really going to look at the numbers that I'm presenting and they're going to do a much better and thorough study than I did. But I did a little loose basic study off of U.S. Census Bureau information and I plotted the gains African Americans were making from 1960 to 1975 educationally and economically. And then I projected that out to 2020, sometime in that period. Yeah. And the crazy thing is that, and the sad thing is that, African Americans would have caught up with whites in educational attainment, graduation from high school, entry into college, completion of college. African Americans would have caught up with whites in economic achievement, income per capita, primarily. Had the gains from the 60s through the 70s, 65 through 75 continued, they would have caught whites between 2000 and 2020. Ladies and gentlemen, it's 2017. The gap wouldn't have been there. The gap wouldn't. What explains it? I believe what explains the gap today is the Southern strategy. That's why it matters. Okay? These policies whittled civil rights legislation. They can't completely take it away, so they hollow it out. You're not going to take away the Civil Rights Act of 1964, nor the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and you're not going to take away the Fair Housing Act of 1968. But perhaps many of you, like me, have seen these policies that keep happening that deny people their rights. And we keep thinking, is that isolated? That must be an isolated incident. Another isolated incident. Look, another isolated incident. And you're trying to figure out, why are these isolated? Hey, maybe these incidents are not so isolated. What explains why this stuff keeps happening? I think this is what. Better than anything else. All right. So where'd it come from? So there's a book out by a scholar, I think he's called Wing Nuts, and it's on the Southern strategy. It just came out like 3 years ago. And I learned from the book, that the author makes the argument that really the Southern strategy ideas that, hey, you Republicans might be able to win the Southern conservative voters, namely white voters, down south, because an opening has presented it suddenly. But you've got to do it very carefully or you will lose the base you already have in the Rocky Mountain area, Northeast, and the other places. To do it, you got to do it in a very deft, careful way. And you're probably not going to be able to do it, to be the conductor from the north, getting the Southerners in. You're going to need help. So in Texas, the way they did it, they had like a televangelist person. I think the person was independent, but somehow he was lending support to Republicans down there. Remember, this Texas is like the South, is a Democratic bastion at the time. And there were some Republican legislators who had grown more conservative and had tired of their party being the Civil Rights Party, the Abraham Lincoln Party for 100 years. And they began to really move right to win. Because it was already a tough proposition for people down there voting for any Republican. But I'm a conservative. I would cut things, and I don't like this race mixing going on and all that. So it started there. Those ideas, once those people from the right began to win, once those Republicans down south in Texas began to win, they brought those ideas into the Congress. And then they were going in 64, they realized Johnson from Texas, a Democrat, passed the Civil Rights Bill. When he passed it, does anybody know what he said on the day that he passed the Civil Rights Bill, 64?
We shall overcome.
There goes
the Democrats voting in the South.
There goes the Democratic vote. There goes the South to the Democratic Party. That's what this is about. They knew that if you stand up for civil rights in the Democratic Party, you make the base of the Democratic Party, which was the racist vote down South, feel like they don't have a party down there. And they will walk away from you. They threatened it in 1948 with Strom Thurmond running as a
justice.
As a what? Starts with a D. As a
Dixiecrat.
To run as a Republican. That's the party of Lincoln.
Oh, okay.
What's the problem for the folks down south with the party of Lincoln? What's the historic problem with that? All right, so the big problem is the war. You fought against my great-great-great-grandfather, right? But it was not just that you fought us, it was how you fought us. So the problem with Lincoln was, who's the person, starts with an S, that led that campaign down south that really hurt the Southerners?
Sherman.
What did Sherman do?
Burned down South, didn't he? It was like super.
Yeah, so he wasn't really supplied very much from Grant and the Northern forces. So it's all right. We're gonna go from Memphis to Atlanta, and we're gonna be supplied by every farm on the way. And that, the Southerners felt, was unforgivable. They despised Lincoln for that. They despised Sherman and the Republican Party. It was a hard thing for Southern conservatives to go Republican. They wanted to watch Wallace in 64 and 68 try to form a third party, a racist third party. Didn't work. They needed a conductor. There's their conductor. Strom Thurmond. Because you don't talk to Southerners about Southern way of life, about political positions to take that are intimate, important. You're a Northern, you're a Westerner. You don't know our ways. They need a Southerner. Strom Thurmond was the first one to leave the Democratic Party and go Republican. He did in 64. One of the first ones. Reagan, too, from the West. But Reagan couldn't do it. They needed this person that led the Dixiecrats in 48. And he went to him and said, listen, I know this is a hard bargain, but with these blacks coming into the Democratic Party, we got to do something, because you know we believe segregation. We don't believe in race mixing. So we gotta go somewhere. If you follow Wallace, you're gonna go over the cliff. You're gonna throw your vote away. third parties don't win in time. So they haven't in the last 150 years. We've got to form, we got to get into a Republican Party, and they are telling me that if you stop saying nigger, excuse my language, some of you don't like use that term. I kind of like it sometime in an educational setting. But it's not bad. It's really not right. But to wake people up and to get you to think about how ugly that term is. You quit saying the N-word. You quit saying states' rights. Clean up your language. You don't have to change your heart. You don't have to change your thinking. You just gotta change your euphemisms and your adverbs and verbs. And you can do what you want. Party's opening the door to you, and if you come in, you'll come in with your seniority and move right to the front of the heads of the committees in Congress. Some of you will be picked to lead agencies and departments in presidential administration. And you will have lost initially the civil rights movement to Martin Luther King, and yet you will win it again, back, slowly, secretly, over the years, stealthily, through a Southern Scratch. It's exactly what happened 100 years ago. What happened 100 years ago? Did the South lose the Civil War? In a sense, they did. But why did they win? Why is it you could argue that they won? We had Reconstruction, they were losing. What happened at the end of Reconstruction? Ah, so what's Jim Crow? Slavery without chains.
The slaves not free.
Just go ask the people that were there. Some say it was worse than slavery. I don't think it was. But some say it was worse because there was no plan for the young and no plan for the elderly. When you could no longer work, you were basically working for free. You couldn't make enough money under segregation to make it. So they felt they were back in. They were working in the same fields. They were picking the same cotton. In a sense, they felt we lost. Southerners, once they got those troops pulled out, came down to the voting booth with rifles, put them in their head and said, "You ain't voting today, I'll blow your head off." It was terrorism. Changed the laws, and then it was legal, just like slavery. And lynching self-enforcing. In a sense, they won. So, something like this is happening now. You have to be careful, you have to win the war and the peace. Okay. Oh, you ready to answer somebody, give me the next slide, but I realize this is manual. Okay, so there's Michael Steele. Then you got this Kevin Phillips quote. Let's see if I have the Kevin Phillips quote. There it is. Now, my dad used to make gumbo. I'm not gonna get through these slides. I can already tell the pace I'm going now. I'm gonna get through like three slides. But anyway, my dad used to make gumbo. And he would make oxtail stew. And he would just start teaching. We listened to him, you know, his dad, you know, doing his dad thing. He started talking. He said, "Never let them put you in the trick bag. Never let them put you in the trick bag. You're trying to tell us you're going to sell them a full bag of something. You know, we come from farming communities. You're going to sell them a full bag of something, but you always got to check. Because sometimes they're going to sell you a bag with rocks in the bottom. A bag that's half of a bag that looks like a full bag, and that weighs what your bag weighs. Can't let them put you in the trip back." Since 1970, we have had this quote. If we would have been wise and discerning, and now I'm including in this the whites, there have always been whites that would give their life for the equality of all people. There haven't been a lot, but there have always been whites here too, and non-blacks. And for Latinos in Texas, it had it about as bad as African Americans did in Mississippi. There have always been blacks and others that would ally with Latinos to try to help them. And for Filipinos and Chinese in San Francisco, LA, Portland, and Seattle, there have always been non-Asian Americans of those types that would support you and fight with you and suffer with you. Just haven't been enough. So a lot of times we've had to work out our battles alone. We should have been able to figure out this Southern strategy coming. At this point, it was coming. It's 1970. Let's unpack this and deconstruct it. From now on, this thing was published. So we've always had this quote. He was the political consultant. Whenever you see political consultant or campaign strategist, don't think that's just a talking head. They're not that important. No, no, you don't understand politics. Your campaign consultant, your political strategist, is the engine of the train of your campaign. They're telling you, pay me, hook on to me and my strategy, and I'm going to get you into the White House, in the Senate, into whatever. But to do it, to win certain blocks and big pieces of money, they got to make promises along the way. To win votes, you have to have a platform. In a sense, that is also a promise. Public one this time, no. But you're making private promises along the way, too. Don't get it wrong. You're bargaining. We call it, you're log rolling. You're making deals. But you're also doing the public ones. That's your platform. Put it on the website. Now, you go to the website. You have to make good on those promises. Or on re-election time, you have a difficult time winning those people back again. All right? So these strategists put your strategy together. And what they say is very important. And sometimes you get the best explanations of the thinking behind the campaign or the thinking of behind the first couple of years of administration. Campaign policy becomes administration policy. From the political consultant, so take them very seriously. All right, Mr. Phillips, what do you have to say? From now on, the Republicans are never going to get more than 10-20% of the Negro vote. This was new. It's 1970. For 100 years, they've been winning the lion's share of the Negro vote. And they don't need any more than that. That we didn't figure this thing out now. We're going to give up the 20% in the South to win 60% of the South. We're going to win the South, and we're going to hold on to our base in other places. Now, you got to follow the rest of them. Most of you are going to miss what he's getting ready to say right here. You're just going to miss it completely, like most everybody else did. But I'm going to ask you to read this in a very discerning way. But Republicans would be short-sighted if they weakened enforcement of the Voting Rights Act. Of course, some words are missing, but even if you put the sentences and the words in that are missing, you'll realize he's still not talking clearly enough. He just said something. I'm trying to figure out, what do you mean by that? What do you think he means by that? Yeah.
I think it means that we need to not be blatant in the way that we fight against civil rights progressives.
Or take away gains they already won. And in fact, there's a more raw way of saying it than that, and a more programmatic and descriptive way of saying it. You can say blatant. We can't go this far in taking their fundamental rights. But he suggested you could go close. Now you're starting to figure this thing out. They knew this in 1970. You're about to take some stuff away. Because that's what these folks that we just brought in want. They want to go back. The more Negroes who register as Democrats in the South, the sooner the Negro, oh, what is a Negro folk? So somebody sees black people go, oh, 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 oh. Is that what it is? Nah, it's more than that. What do you think they're saying? Oh, they're saying, we don't know. How can I get in his mind, Winston?
If they're to be like in opposition of the Voting Rights Act, and that's going to stop the people who don't want black people to be a part of the Democratic Party to like from entering the Republican Party. It's like a funnel for them. So.
And guess what else he's saying?
He's also saying that when more black people go into the Democratic Party, those racist white people are going to go into the Republican Party.
That's the word. That's what he's saying. But why can't he say racist?
Because they're trying to clean up their vocabulary.
Because it is. It's 1970 now. Right. What do you have in 1970? Oh, you got a 1964 Civil Rights Act. You got a 1965 Voting Rights Act. And you got a 1968 Fair Housing Act that will get you sued. So he had to find a term. He did a good job, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
He did a good job finding a term that made his point just enough, but would keep the undiscerning from trapping him into the new legal rubric that could give you the blowback. That's pretty good. And this is what I get on people in the civil rights community for. You should have, that was enough. So you said that's where the votes come from. Now you start to figure out the Southern strategy. Can't be clear. Not publicly. You can't really explain it. Not publicly. You can hint, but you can't be blatant. That's the Southern strategy. But you're winking and nodding, dog whistling, and then when you close the door, and on the old Maxwell Smart day, you guys don't know, you're too young, you don't know Maxwell, get smart. You're too young, you're too young. Ask your grandparents. You can put the cone of silence down, and then you can really have a conversation. But he would talk too loud in the cone of silence, and then the chief would just raise up the cone of silence. You're hurting my head. It's not funny. My humor is real small, real. It's kind of humorettes, the humorettes, the little joke. You need a microscope. He's like, oh, there's the joke. It's down there by the amoeba. All right, there's Michael Steele. Oh, you can't see him. Actually, if I lifted that up, it'd only be stupid because it's a screen. It's plastic on it. But that's Michael Steele. This is a, can you see him now?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, see how the automation, is working? Let's push the button and it did like that. Okay. So, let's see if I'm leaving out a quote, though. I think I got to go back one. Now, this is deep right here. We didn't get this one until about, let me see now. Well, wait a minute. I put it like this. I didn't learn about this. This is Haldeman Diary. I didn't learn about this one until I was downtown Seattle around 2010. At the ACLU office, someone said, hey, Lips, do you want to be invited in this special meeting? We got former Chief Stamper talking about his book on policing and why it sometimes leads to overreaction and killing of blacks and all that. And I'm like, yeah, I'll come. So I'm down there, just listening to it, this big oval table. Chief Stamper said, now we know, Chief Stamper now, he's not black. Now we know why the Nixon administration really did the war on drugs. I'm just listening. He said it was because they were going after blacks. I said, what? And what's your basis for saying that? He said, well, Haldeman's diary just came out. I said, what? I'm taking another time. Yeah. You know that. He said, you gotta get that. And it tells you that they were targeting blacks. I was like, I've been looking for that. Then I'm looking at the other people when he said it, other people went, oh, isn't that something? And then he just went to the third point. Maybe I'm a hypocrite. If they said that against your group, how about I flip the table over? How about I would stop? Maybe I am a hypocrite, actually. Because sometimes people do a lot of talking. Then you go, listen, what about the homeless people? What have you done for them? They've been on Broadway a long time. What about, you know, any group that's been fighting for their rights? Where you been? Maybe I am, too. But the fact that people can hear that, or the fact that you guys could hear this lecture today and go, oh, that was deep, and then just go on. I can't go on, and I have a problem with this. I'm stuck right here. I smile and see down the hall and talking, but you guys don't know how much I cry about this. I mean, this is like, we should stop the country and go, hey, we're going to fix this. All right? This just came out. P stands for what? President. He's just taking notes. These are his notes. Monday, April 28th, 1969. He says that about everything. He's writing whatever he said that day. We're gonna go meet with Israel. And P said we're gonna meet with Israel. Da 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 da. P emphasized. Now wait a minute. This is April 28th, 1969. He only been off for 3 months. February, end of March, end of April. You've only been in office 3 months. You get elected in 68. You're going to do an inaugural address at the end of January. He emphasized that you have to face the fact that the whole problem is really the blacks. The key is to devise the system. At first he said they've never had a successful system. And he had just met with some black leaders that were asking for some things that he felt were unreasonable. And telling him, we're real concerned about the racist leanings of your party now. This used to be our party too, and we feel it's not welcome to us anymore. And he's like, man, you're asking me for things I can't do. So instead of trying to listen to them and go back, which is going forward, to what they used to be, the big civil rights party, he said, no, they're the problem. They're asking me to do something I can't. They're the problem. And then he said, you know what? The worst of all of the systems, you gotta go and catch this whole quote, is Liberia. And we produce that. Y'all don't even know about Liberia. I bet you. Is there anybody knows about Liberia? What is the unique thing about Liberia? I saw your hand first.
Me or?
Yeah, your hand, sir.
So Liberia is a nation that is formed by freed slaves that returned after.
Slaves from the United States. It's really kind of like the 51st state or something. We have never treated them like they matter. Never treat them like they know. Name the capital, Monrovia, the president, Monroe at the time, said the official language was English, but people wouldn't speak English on the western side of Africa. Official religion is Christianity, and they always wanted to accept this from us. And he said they're the worst. He said, he emphasized that you have to face the fact that the whole problem is really the blacks. The key is to devise a system that recognizes this while not appearing. Ladies and gentlemen, the author of the Southern Strategy is this man and the people around him. And they devised the system. They recognized certain people as the problem. And it never appeared like it was being done. He wrote it that day. Then they went out and did it. Or at least that's my argument. My argument is, he was telling the truth that day. Oh, it was always there in the quote. I didn't even see the bottom of it. I thought, you gotta go out and get it, but it's right there. He gives the justification for it. Woo! I almost killed the English language on that. Okay, now you got these Republicans admitting it too. That's a good thing. So I don't have to prove that it exists. It already exists. It's already been admitted to. I just have to hone it and tweak it a little bit to show that they continue to do it and that its effects are more sinister than we're showing. All right? But I'm going to tell you a place I really like to go, and that's Rachel Maddow. And I can't do it now because I've been talking too long. Please, I'll leave the this PowerPoint with someone. Then you guys, thank you. And then you guys can get the PowerPoint. Hit Rachel Maddow. She heard Michael Steele give that quote in 2010, and 3 days later, she was on the job. And she did a nice little 10 to 15 minute piece on the Southern strategy. Okay? And we know she does good work. So you can catch it. All right. Here's Reagan doing the Southern strategy. He opens up his campaign in Neshoba County in actually, I've forgotten him. I don't know why I forgot him. Neshoba County, where the three civil rights workers were killed, Cheney, Schwerner, and Goodman, I think. And why am I forgetting? I think it was Mississippi, but you guys just have to check me out. And it's right there. He stood on the ground where their bodies were found. No, you got to back up. He advertised. Nick Reagan opening his campaign, come to talk to us. Where's he going? He's going to go to the ground where their bodies were found and stand on that ground and tell you, I'm starting my campaign. Because all got to be secretive and subtle. So you got to say a lot through the little bit you can say and the little bit you can do. So he tried to kind of convey. A new sheriff is in town and we're getting ready to do some things that's going to win our country back and deal with the people in the way of our winning our country back. And he used the term states' rights. So this is straight from Wikipedia. And it says, Republican candidate Ronald Reagan made a much-noted appearance at the Neshoba County Fairgrounds. The I Believe in States' Rights speech, that's really the only justification during the Civil War for slavery from the Southern side. It's a states' rights matter. Leave it up to the states. National government, you don't stay involved. You don't get involved with it. He made that old argument to those people who knew what that meant. And they went, man, this is a good old boy. We can work with him. I guess Strom Thurmond's right. And the last of them came on board with Reagan. Reagan did. And then when he got in office, he made good on the promises. But he said at every step, I believe in equality for all people. Because got to be secret. I believe in treating people right. Got to be secret. Then you just secretly undo the things they need. Hey, it might be fraud in elections and allow voter ID stuff and taken away from the Voting Rights Act. And, you know, I think you should let people do what they want to do so you pull back enforcement of the 64 Act. And what Reagan did is he put a black named Clarence Thomas over the EEOC office, and Clarence Thomas wouldn't hear any of the complaints. He backloaded all of them. Complaints that were supposed to be heard in 60 to 90 days, Clarence Thomas held it for 3 years. And you know what they said about Clarence Thomas? He is ready to be on the Supreme Court. You just proved yourself. So they put him on the most famous court for preparation on the Supreme Court, which is the D.C. Circuit. Then they made him Supreme Court Justice. This is the biggest quote, and this is one that changed me, and I gotta stop on this one. This one changed me. This one was never supposed to be revealed. This link will give you the audio tape. And if we should have ever figured it out, we really should have figured it out after that quote. This is another campaign consultant. He put Reagan in, in 84. He was the boy wonder when he was in undergrad. He was in one of the conservative organizations in undergrad that showed his bona fides fighting some of the more left-leaning things at the college, and he went, woo, this guy's good. And they picked him up in the Republican Party and put him in important places. Next thing you know, he's the boy wonder, helping to get Reagan selected. He was honed by Strom Thurmond. And he said, first thing he said is, you're not writing this down, are you? Somebody asked him a question, and he said, you're not writing this down, are you? And then he began to say, and he explained the whole thing. You start out in 1954 by saying, nigga, nigga, nigga. By 1968, you can't say nigga. That hurts you. Backfires. So you say stuff like force busing, states' rights, and stuff, and all that stuff. Now, wait a minute, if you're following this, what did he just tell you is really being said when those people say busing, states' rights, and all that stuff? What are they really saying? Oh, I think it's worse than that. He just told you what they really said.
Reinforcing racism.
Pardon me?
Reinforcing racism.
Because you don't want to say the N-word, do you?
Reinforcing hetero, well, there's superiority.
No. Okay, but you know what I think he's really saying? When they say, because you can't say it, force, but I'm just messing with you now. That's why I ain't got any friends. Putting words in people's mouth, bothering people. When they say force, busing, states' rights, and all that stuff, they're really saying nigga, nigga, nigga. That's what he just said. And I stopped there because I bet you you're just going to do a euphemisms of it, or you're going to miss the whole point. And you're going to realize you didn't catch it from the beginning.
Law and order.
What does that mean?
Law and order, that's another one. The Trump campaign's got all his old
makeup. But there you go. It's another statement. It's another code word. You're getting so abstract now. You're talking about cutting taxes. He's telling you, cutting taxes goes here, which is a 1968 way of saying what we used to say in 54. And it's not just even saying that, it's meaning that. And it's all about place. These things you're talking about are totally economic things. And the byproduct of them is that blacks get hurt worse than whites. Blacks get hurt worse than whites. Blacks get hurt worse than whites. Then he goes and says, that means I gotta be quiet now. That's the problem I got. He can't fit it in a box. He's just all, see what I mean? So this, it was teaching this 2 years ago that finally one day the light bulb came on and I realized this is the test that I can use to out the Southern Strap. I had a discrimination case. I was the attorney representing the Merchants, a manipulative therapist suing Century 21 of the Tomato Islands. That's when I learned about civil rights law. And what I learned is sometimes you can shift the burden and you only have to, in some things you don't have to prove your whole case in the same way that in normal cases you have to prove your case. That the court recognized discrimination is going underground, so all you gotta do is make it like a half shoulder. It's the prima facie case, and the burden shifts because of past discrimination. And the other side's gotta come out and say a reason for why they did it that better be non-racist. And then the burden comes back on you, and then the case becomes, was their reason the right thing, or did you prove your case that it was discrimination? I went, wow, I wonder if I can make the argument, a burden-shifting argument, that since we have had a history of past discrimination, and since I get hope now from campaign consultants saying you're doing a secretive plan to take away people's rights, with that history, and I got now one quote from Haldeman that we just got, outing the war on poverty and of the war on drugs, can I now say any time a Republican, and maybe even a Democrat, passes a law that hurts black people worse than whites, if I can show that, shouldn't then the burden shift to you to prove that it's not the Southern Strat? You did it in Merchants versus Century 21. We do it all over the country on civil rights matters. I mean, let Trump get around that. Let the news media get a hold of that every time you start crafting the law. Maybe we can out it like that. And when when I sent that to a class, I ran back and got to typing. And that's where the 65 pages started coming. I'm going to stop right here because I have to, because I can feel a hook on my neck. And so I'm done. Yeah,
but... Please join me in thanking Carl.
Yes, my lecture is done. Now it's just all questions.
Okay, now questions.